Hey, Joe Gilder here from Home Studio Corner. Today we're going to talk about side chaining, what it is, how to use it, what situations you want to use it, and how to set it up. Now, I'm going to explain for a couple minutes what side chaining is and define it and some common uses of it, and then I'll show you, we'll hop into a session and I'll show you how to set it up. Now, there will always be someone who will complain that I'm talking too much, just get to the showing us what buttons to push. That's not learning. If I just pulled up a video and said, hey, we're gonna click this, click this, click this, and you're done, that wouldn't help you, because if we don't set the context of what side chaining is and when and why we would use it, then knowing how to set up the routing and the plugins is fairly useless. So I'm trying to give you a cohesive approach. It's like going to the doctor. I don't want to go see a doctor who has just memorized a treatment plan but doesn't really understand how the human body works and how to diagnose and take different information and make good medical decisions from them. And it's the same in the studio. Less people die, but still, you want to know why you're doing what you're doing and have that understanding behind it, and then the technical how you do it is really the easy part. So what is side chaining? Side chaining is taking the signal from one track and using that signal to trigger something else to happen on another track. That's the loose definition of side chaining. I personally don't use side chaining a whole lot in my mixes, but there are situations where I do, and it's important to know how it works. Typically, although not exclusively, side chaining involves compression. So I made some visual aids. Please don't be embarrassed about how amazing my drawing skills are. You've got track number one. And this Amazon Basics paper is awful. It's like fax paper. So you've got track number one. Track number one is what you could consider to be the trigger track. The important component here is that it has a send that is sending this audio somewhere else. We'll get to that in a second. Track number two. The important thing here is this track has a compressor plugin on it. Now, where it gets fun is this compressor on track number two isn't listening to track number two, but it is compressing track number two. It's listening to track number one. So we're using a send on track number one to trigger the compressor, but the compressor isn't compressing track number one, it's compressing track number two based on what it hears from track number one. Now that's all well and good. You could walk into intro to audio class and I could explain that to you and you'd say, okay, but what does that matter? Let me talk about some common situations where you might use side chaining. One really common example is ducking. So in the radio world, the voiceover world, you might have a DJ who's talking over a music bed. One of the options is for him to literally have his finger on the fader for the music, and when he's not talking, he pushes the fader up and there's music, and then when he starts to talk, he can pull the fader down. But if you don't want to be constantly riding the fader and you want it to be more automatic, ducking would be the way to go. So in that scenario, the vocal will be on track number one with a send going over to the music track on track number two, specifically sending over to that compressor. So every time the DJ speaks, the music gets turned down. You've probably heard that on radio shows before. Music's nice and loud, DJ starts talking, music goes down. DJ stops talking, music comes back up. And the attack and release settings of that compressor determine how quickly it gets turned down and how slowly it turns back up when he's done talking. Another common example in the mixing world is having the bass guitar ducked by the kick drum. So when the kick drum hits, that triggers the compressor on the bass to turn it down briefly so the bass and the kick drum don't interfere. I personally almost never use that, but it's a common technique you probably want to know about. A more advanced example is taking something like a simple synth pad, like a bzzz sounding pad, and then using something like an eighth note hi-hat track to trigger a gate instead of a compressor on that synth pad. So the gate is set to have the synth pad all the way down, basically muted. And then whenever a signal comes from the hi-hat, say this hi-hat is going t-t-t-t-t like that, then that will trigger the gate. It will open the gate to let the synth sound through. So it's the same concept, except instead of a compressor, we're using a gate. So if the synth goes like this normally, and then we use that side chaining with the gate to trigger it off of a hi-hat sound, suddenly the synth goes, you've heard that in lots of like pop and hip hop and things like that, you'll hear these synths that have this rhythmic thing to them. That doesn't always mean that's how the sound's created, but that's one way to do that. And a lot of times you might have this trigger sound, this hi-hat track, muted in the mix. It's turned all the way down. It's just using a pre-fade or send to send that trigger signal over to the synth's gate to give it that rhythmic pattern. That's way more advanced than I really wanted to get into, but it does exist and it's something you can play around with. Now, that's enough introduction. Let me jump into Studio One and show you a specific scenario where I have used sidechaining and it works really well.
All right, here's my song Whitewash. Here's the lead vocal by itself. It's got processing on it, normal mix processing, compression, de-esser, stuff like that. It also has a slapback delay with some distortion on it, and here's what it sounds like.
The talk of the town, that boy got around.
Now let's just say we wanted there to be something to fill those little gaps between vocal phrases. We thought, yeah, you know, something like a quarter note delay might be cool. Well, I always have a quarter note delay in my session ready to go. So I'm going to use a send on my vocal track to send it to this quarter note delay track over here. Let's see what that sounds like.
The talk of the town, that boy got around.
I like the idea, but while the vocal is singing, it's too distracting. It interrupts the vocal. But at the ends of the phrases, could be cool to have that delay come in. Now, we could automate all that, and it would take us quite a while to automate all those little volume changes, or we could use sidechaining. So I've put a compressor over here on my delay track. After the delay plugin, there is a compressor plugin. Now, check it out. I've got it set to pretty aggressive, so really high ratio, threshold, we can figure out where that needs to be, really fast attack, and a middle-of-the-road release. And over here, at least in Studio One, and your plugins will be different depending on what DAW you're using, it says sidechain. Now, I can't select anything over here, but it does seem to indicate that I can have some sort of external sidechain. Now, how do I get there? Well, we go back to the original vocal track. We've got our sends here for the delays. We can create another send and go down here under sidechains. We can look at all the plugins in the session that can accept some sort of sidechain input. So we just go find our quarter note delay track, the compressor plugin, boom. So now we are sending a copy of the vocal to that compressor. For good measure, I will change it to pre-fader, so no matter what I do over here on this track, it doesn't change the volume going to that trigger on that compressor. And now when I hit play, I'm going to mute the audio for a second, but when I hit play, you can see this compressor is being triggered by this vocal track, even though this compressor is actually on the delay track, not on the vocal track. Now, let's see what that sounds like. What's happening is when the vocal sings, the delay is being turned down. When the vocal stops singing, the delay gets turned back up. Let's see what that sounds like.
The talk of the town, that boy got around.
You hear what happened there? At the very end of the phrase, round. As soon as I said duh, the compressor let go and the delay came back up. Is it the right choice for this song? I don't know, but you get the idea. It is turning that delay down until the vocal stops singing or gets really quiet, and then the delay comes back in. Listen to the difference. If I turn off this compression, listen to how that delay sounds.
The talk of the town.
Way too loud, way too much. It doesn't work at all. With the compressor on, we're now slapping that delay into submission while the vocalist is singing and then allowing it to come back up for air between phrases.
The talk of the town, that boy got around, and the powers that be made him disappear.
Pretty fun stuff. And as you can imagine, you can get really creative and potentially even go overboard with this, but it's a whole functionality that a lot of people don't realize exists, and chances are it's already right there in your system waiting for you to try it out.
All right, that wraps it up. If you love mixing like I do and you don't have a system for working through your mix from start to finish, you kind of feel like a chicken with its head cut off, sorry to all the chicken lovers out there, and you just kind of go and do lots of different things in kind of a crazy pattern, maybe you need a system. Maybe you need to check out my 5-step mix guide. It's absolutely free. Go to 5stepmix.com to download it and check it out. Thanks for watching the video. See you in the next one.
The talk of the town, that boy got around.